Jesus.
God, you are high and lifted up. Here before all, before master. This life is yours and not my own. Eternal reign from your throne. Jesus, this is your story. You came down in love, you conquered the grave. This is your story. You came down in power and I'm caught up in grace. I fall in love with you. Found my life in you. We're aligned with you. Jesus, my story. Is set on solid stone. We worship you and you alone. We worship you and you alone. Jesus, this is your story.
Thank you so much for spending your Sunday here with us. Our service will be commencing in 3 minutes. Hey there, enjoyers. Our service will be commencing in 1 minute.
My redemption, after all that you've done. on me. My faith
is
in only
you,
Jesus.
My faith is in only you,
only you, Jesus.
My faith
is in
only you,
only you, Jesus.
My faith is in only you, only you. My faith is in only you. After all. Sing, oh my soul, oh my soul.
You alone are worthy, God. There is no one like you, Lord. And this morning we just fix our gaze upon your beauty, Lord. Open our eyes to see you, Lord, in a new way. And church, as we continue to worship this morning, if you have a need in your life, you're praying and believing for something, why don't you make your way down to the front? Our team of leaders are here ready to pray with you, believe with you. And the song we're singing is talking about faith. Our faith is in Jesus. Our hope is in Him. If you're believing for healing, if you're believing for breakthrough, we serve a God who is almighty, who is powerful. We don't live by what we see. We live by faith. Amen. So if that's you this morning, why don't you make your way down to the front? And the rest of us, why don't we lift our hands, gaze upon our beautiful Jesus this morning. Blinded by my sight, Cause my faith's in Jesus' name. I'm not running from the fire. I choose faith always. I'm not blinded by my sight. Cause my faith's in Jesus' name. I'm not running from the fire.
All of heaven seen, your majesty. for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor anything in all creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Can I encourage you? Let's thank Him for His love. Let's thank Him for His goodness. Let's thank Him, for He is worthy. He is worthy of all the praise. He is worthy of all the honor, all the glory. And if you're in this place and you have a prayer request here this morning, can I encourage you? He is a faithful and consistent God. He is a good God to bring your prayer request before. He cares. He loves you. Sometimes we forget how much He loves us. He so loves you, church. And so if you're in this place and you have a prayer request this morning, why don't you raise your hands with me and let's pray together. Let's join our faith together. Let's also pray for these prayer requests on the cross. So Jesus, we thank You, God, for You are holy and worthy of all the honor, worthy of all the praise, Lord. We bring every prayer request in this place before You. You see every need. You see every heart. We pray, Lord Jesus, Lord, I pray that You will have Your way, that Your will shall be done. I pray, God, that we will hear Your voice clearer. Lord, I pray that we will discern what You want to do in each situation. I pray for strength. I pray for provision. I pray for healing. I pray for joy. I pray for peace. Lord Jesus, we bring every need into Your hands, into Your heart, Lord God. We pray and we bring it before Your cross now, Lord. We thank You in advance for all You will do, and mostly for who You are, Lord. We are so thankful that we get to know You, Lord. We commit it into Your house this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't we give Him one more shout of praise in this place this morning? Amen. Well, welcome to church this morning, everybody. Welcome, welcome, Pastor Christian.
Good morning, church. How you doing? How good is it to be in church on a Sunday?
So good.
I'm going to say it to great. The day that the Lord takes me to heaven. Sunday is my favorite day of the week.
Amen.
If we could have Sunday every day, I would make Sunday every day, would you?
Absolutely.
But we'd get confused what day it is.
Yeah, but that's Sunday, all right, Sunday. Best day ever.
Well, you guys are sounding amazing today.
Yes. Why don't you turn to the person next to you, give them a big high five. Say it's great to see them before taking your seat.
High five.
High five.
High five, team. High five.
High five, high five, high five. Amen. We have a great day today.
We do.
Coming
we
up.
We do. We have the honor of having Pastor Alan and Joan Davies with us today. We cannot wait for the word this morning. Pastor Shane and Georgie send their love. They're currently in Kansas, yeah?
Yes.
They won the Super Bowl.
Did they?
They're at the Rock of KC,
yes,
ministering. They're not watching in, but we'll say hello anyway if they watch it later. They send their love.
Yes, absolutely.
But we want to welcome a special group of people.
Yeah,
today.
Absolutely. Right at the outset of the service, we want to take a moment to welcome all of our guests here this morning. If you are a guest with us today, I want to say a big thank you for choosing to spend part of your Sunday here with us today. And, you know, we would love the opportunity to meet you at your very own guest lounge out at the Hub.
It is their very own guest lounge.
It
no one else is allowed
own.
To go in there.
Yes.
Only if you're a guest.
Yes.
And we have teams that are ready to take your coffee order.
Yes.
And we have not
or
just...
Or iced coffee.
Iced coffee now.
Yeah, or iced chocolate.
Or chocolate if you don't drink coffee.
Yes.
I drink coffee, but yeah. Don't go to the cafe line. Go straight to the guest lounge because we'd love to meet you.
Yeah, absolutely. One of our core values is relationship. And so
that's
we
right.
love the opportunity to meet you and for you to meet some of our team as well. And so we've prepared a welcome pack for you, just for you, with some information about our church as well as your next steps to getting planted here. So we would love to put one of these into your hands. So why don't you raise your hand and one of our team will run one of these out to you. Come
welcome,
on, enjoy
welcome,
it.
Welcome, welcome.
Let's give our guests a
any
massive
guests?
Welcome.
Oh, over there. Welcome. Welcome, brother. Welcome.
Welcome. So great to have you here this morning. Very, very cool.
Well, we're going to tell them what's going on in Joy World, yeah?
Yes, we are.
And every week we say we have a jam-packed week because every week we have a jam-packed week. We've always got something on for you.
Yes, yes.
Starting with...
Today. Starting with today, Pastor
Christian. Don't even have to wait till Monday.
We don't have to wait till Monday. Today in our 11:30 service, we have Grow Track happening. Come on, if you've done Grow Track...
Tell us about Grow Track, because what am I clapping for? What is Grow Track?
Well, Grow Track is where you can learn a little bit more about who we are, but it's actually very cool because you get to learn a little bit more about the gifts and talents that God has given you and your unique part to play in building the house. And so I've done Grow Track. I loved it. I received so much from it, and I know so many enjoyers have done it and received so much as well. So
I heard it's not too late to sign up.
Not too late to sign up.
Head to the hub after the service.
Yes.
Sign up for Grow Track, and it's in our second service.
Yeah, why don't you hang around, get a coffee with some people, and then stay for Grow Track?
Yeah.
Why not?
I loved Segre Creative Night a month ago. It was my last Creative Night, and I'm not allowed to go back, but I loved the word that Pastor Aaron brought to Creative Night. And this Wednesday is Creative Night here at our West location, MP1.
Next Wednesday. So it's a week and 3 days. Pastor Christian's very excited
See?
About Creative Night.
I don't care about creative anymore. I'm not a creative pastor anymore. Whenever it is, go
yes.
to it.
So next Wednesday, the 24th of April, come on down, 7:30 p.m. It's for every person who's either part of the creative family or if you are interested in joining creative, you love painting, you love
drawing,
lighting,
lights,
you love productions,
all of it.
You love dance, all of it. Come on down, hang
Pastor
out
Ralph
with us.
Pastor Ralph loves interpretive dance.
Yes,
Pastor Ralph,
we have invited you. Maybe you could
dance.
Do an item, Pastor Ralph,
yeah.
for
us.
I love
Spirit
that music.
Fingers.
Yeah, so it'll be such a good time. So come on down, hang out. It'll be awesome.
Cool. I'm going to come over here now.
Yes.
Because I want to tell you about our Empire lunch, which is next week. But it's not for Empire Crew, so don't woo. It's for parents. It's for the parents of anyone that goes to Empire.
Yes.
Has anyone wondered what happens on a Friday night, yeah, at Empire? You've wondered, yeah? Well, I've wondered that, and I always go in to MP1 and have a bit of a sneak peek at what's going on because my daughter is in Empire now, so I
yes.
feel like, you know, I'm a little biased, invested interest into it. But I actually love what happens at our Empire ministry. Pastor Nathan, you are doing an incredible job, and he wants to put a lunch for any parent that has wondered like me, what happens at Empire? So in this lunch that you're providing, yeah? Yeah, he's providing, he's
personally
shouting us
providing.
Lunch.
Personally yes.
providing, thank you very much. It's on Sunday, guys. We've got to change that slide. Thank you for giving us the right correct information here. He'll tell you about
He's
the vision, where they're going, what our Empire crew are doing,
yes.
and it's going to be an incredible, informative, but also parents should be invested in where their kids and what their kids are doing. So I'll be there because my kid goes to, or my daughter goes to Empire. So
yes.
thank you for hosting a lunch next Sunday, yeah? Not Wednesday,
Why don't
you Sunday.
Give it up? Why don't you give it up for the Empire crew? They're awesome. And hey, for more on what's coming up around April and May, head out to the hub and pick up a What's Coming Up flyer.
Thank you, Pastor M.
Thank you.
All right, are you still with me? Yeah, we're still with you? We're going to come around a time of giving. We're going to continue our worship. I like using that line because it is an act of worship. The giving options will be on the back screen, or you can head to the hub after the service, or the containers will be passed if you want to use good old-fashioned cash. So I've wondered for years. This is Nick. He's our guitarist here. How good was worship today? How good was worship? I've always wondered if you stole this from an 80s telephone, like, you know those 80s telephones that reached every room in the house? Is this where you got that? Did you repurpose that?
100%. Yeah.
100%. 100%. It is the coolest looking lead I've ever seen. And I'm listening to your guitar bits and they're amazing, yeah? And for when I started in productions, I got taught one thing by Pastor Michael Goyne. Signal path is so important. It doesn't matter how good your guitar is. It doesn't matter how good the player is, and you're very good. You practice a lot?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, definitely practice a lot. It doesn't matter how fancy or your pedals in are. If the signal from his guitar is plugged in the wrong thing, sometimes I used to have a pedal board like that. complicated. No, it was not as big as that. But if you'd plug it in the wrong place, the signal would just go into itself and nothing would happen. Like, play something for us. Like, play something for us. Well, you've got the signal path happening. Yeah? Yeah, that's right. Nothing. It is so important that the signal path is connected in the right direction. In the same way, there's a signal path of obedience in our tithes and in our generosity with our offerings. Between, all right, here's where the signal path goes, from our heart to our treasure, from our heart to our wallets, to our heart, from our heart to our resources. In Matthew 6:19, it says, Jesus says this, "Don't store up treasures here on earth where moth eat them and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasure in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in. Wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your heart will also be." God is not asking for our finances or our money. He's asking for our hearts. Jesus isn't really concerned with the treasure. He's concerned with the state of our hearts. He understands that our treasure actually lead our hearts, the signal path. He wants our hearts to be pointed on heavenly things and not towards earthly things. So he instructs us to store up treasures in heaven. And church, let me tell you, when we use our resources to advance the kingdom of God, you'll find that your heart becomes more attached to his will. Let me say that again. When we align our resources to advancing God's kingdom, our hearts will also be more aligned to his will. So, last thought. We don't become great givers because we are generous. We become generous because we choose to be great givers. As the team come forward, let's bow our heads and pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you, Jesus, that you've given us this kingdom key, God. Lord, where our treasure is, there our hearts will also be. And we pray that our hearts will be aligned and pointed towards you, God, towards your kingdom, towards heavenly things. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Why don't you turn your eyes to the screens and check out what's going on in Enjoy World.
Hey everyone, welcome to Enjoy News. My name is Nathan and it's so great to have you here with us today. Before we check out some of what's coming up around Enjoy, I wanted to share an update with you on Empire Winter Camp. On behalf of the Empire team across all locations, we're super excited to announce that we're pivoting from Empire Camp to Empire Conference. We believe this is going to give youth a great opportunity to position themselves in the house of God. Empire Conference is going to be running from the 11th to the 12th of July, starting on Thursday night and ending Friday night. And over these sessions, we're believing to equip, empower, and release the youth into their God-given purpose. We're so excited for high schoolers to gather as the Youth Ministry of Enjoy Church with one heart and one mind. It's going to be amazing, and we can't wait to see your youth there. Here's some highlights from our last Empire Conference.
What are you doing on May the 5th?
Nothing much, probably just something boring. How about you?
Yeah, just the same.
Hey, what's that?
I think it's a secret box.
Let's go check it out.
Whoa, what is that?
It's a super epic Sunday flyer.
Hey!
Hey guys, I've got a whole bunch of super epic Sunday flies right here.
That's it for Enjoy News. Now remember, here at Enjoy Church, say it with us, everyone. No one stands alone. Have an awesome week.
You guys are on fire. I could hear no one stands alone from the front all the way to the back. Why don't we stand up for a sec? Because I want to introduce Pastor Alan Davies. We were having a chat upstairs and both of you have gone over 50 years of ministry together. You've blessed so many of us. Pastor Alan has been the ACC state president. He's been on the national. When Pastor Ralph graduated Bible College, it was Pastor Alan who was the president who did their graduation. You've blessed us for so many years. 15 years I've been here, 37 years. We are honored to have you in the house today. Bring the word. So church, why don't you welcome Pastor Alan as he brings the word.
Thank you. Wow. What a fantastic service. Please take your seats. I was blessed. I go to a lot of churches now, different church every weekend. And not all of them leave you feeling blessed. As you already know, I'm not telling you something you don't know, but oh, I tell you what, I feel blessed here. And thank you for the opportunity of being with you. So Pastor Shane's in Kansas. What was that phrase? You're not in Kansas now, Dorothy? But he is in Kansas now. What does that mean? I don't know. Anyway. So thank you for this marvelous opportunity. And don't forget to pray for your pastor and Georgie as they're over there ministering and praying for God to bless them and use them mightily, as he will. We all know that, but you need to stand with them in prayer. Amen? Stand with them in prayer. Praise God. So I want to pray for your pastor, but I also want to pray for the people of Sydney and that terrible event that happened yesterday and all the families and people that are connected to it. Can we do that for a moment? Father, we just pray for Pastor Shane and Georgie right now, Lord, that you would bless them. I know that you're with them, but let them sense your presence powerfully and mightily. And whatever they're doing today, Father, put your hand upon it and bless them and anoint them that they may fulfill your purpose for their life and be a great blessing to people. Let the Spirit of God flow mightily through them, I pray. And Lord, I pray for the families and the people connected to every victim of this terrible atrocity in Sydney. And I just pray that you would uphold them right now and comfort them right now. And Father, we just pray for your presence to be felt among so many of them, Father, and that you lead them to yourself, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So, what do I do today? I mean, you're a good bunch of people, so I should preach a sermon, but I thought I'd tell you a story instead. Most people want a story rather than a sermon. So I want to tell you a story about a man called Jehoshaphat. This is not jumping Jehoshaphat. I don't know who he was, but Jehoshaphat is a king in Jerusalem. Now, let me give you a bit of background. The nation of Israel has been divided into two parts after the death of Solomon. And two-part tribes are in Jerusalem. The rest of them separated themselves. And so you had two kings, one the king of Israel, one the king of Judah, who was situated in Jerusalem. But at this particular time, the king of Israel is a man called Ahab. He's one of the bad guys, okay? And the king of Jerusalem, Jehoshaphat, is one of the good guys. But what happens is Ahab convinces Jehoshaphat to actually combine together and go to war. And stupid Jehoshaphat actually did that, and he went to war with Ahab. Now, it didn't turn out so good. Ahab was killed in that war, and Jehoshaphat ran away with his army, having been defeated, and they tried to kill him too. So he comes back to Jerusalem. Now, you can imagine he's just got out of this by the skin of his teeth. He's afraid, right? He's defeated, okay? This is not a good time for him. He made a terrible mistake. And then they come to him, and this is what they said. They said to him, "Oh, King, we got some bad news for you." Listen to what they say. They say, "A vast army is coming for you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea." And alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord. Now, that's a nice translation, okay? Let me tell you the truth. What happened was, because of the defeat, many nations around about thought they would take this opportunity to attack Jerusalem, overthrow them, wipe them out, because they'd already been defeated. So they thought they're weakened. The king is already afraid, so he'll give in very easily. So they get together, all these mobs of people, all these different groups of people who don't normally cooperate, and they rush down to Jerusalem and they say, "Right, we're going to kill you all." And the hills are covered with thousands of them. And Jehoshaphat, who was already defeated and already afraid, he's now terrified, right? He just escaped with his life, and he thought he was coming home for some rest and peace. Put his feet up, recover, you know, get over this terrible experience, this trauma that he's just had in a battlefield. But now, this other enemy, they've all got together, and they're going to wipe him out. And he is vastly outnumbered. There's just no hope in the world that he can deal with this. So what does he do? It says that he prayed. He prayed. Now, you've got to admit, he's desperate, yeah? And unfortunately, that's when most of us pray. However, it doesn't stop prayer from working when you're desperate, right? But perhaps we should do it when we're not desperate, not just leave it to when we are desperate. And if this man had prayed, before he'd made his mistake and gone to war with the wrong guy, he wouldn't be in this situation right now. So the only reason now that he's terrified having to pray is because he didn't pray when he should have prayed. We all do that. Don't look at me like that. We all do that. Thank God we have a loving, gracious, kind Father. Amen? He's good. I mean, he does say, "Well, you should have done it before," but he doesn't then say, "I'm not going to answer your prayers," right? He's kind and loving. So I want you to listen to what Jehoshaphat prayed, because this is really important, all right? Just bear with me in the story for a minute. You okay? All right, good. Okay. He says, "Lord, the God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven?" Well, yeah. "You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you." Now, that's a good statement, right? He believes in God who's ruling over all. Literally, he's saying, "You are the great one, the only one, the almighty God. There's none greater than you. You hold all power in your hand." This is who he's going to in his prayer. Huh? He's not going to some little God, some feeble God, some, "Oh God, please, if you could possibly, you know." No, he's not doing that. He's going to the great creator of heaven and earth, the mighty God. Amen. When Paul writes to the Ephesians, he says, "I pray that your eyes of your understanding would be opened." Why? Because we don't really have open eyes to who God really is. "That you might know him," he says. "Know him who is exceedingly above all things." We've got to see the greatness of God. I want to tell you, you do not understand the greatness of God, for however big you think he is, he's a lot bigger than that. There is no way your mind and your imagination can comprehend the greatness of our God. And so this is what this guy's praying for. He says, "This is it, Lord." And then he says, "Oh God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you." You ever been there? You ever been there? Outnumbered, outgunned, overwhelmed, so many problems, so many difficulties. You don't have solutions. You don't have answers. You don't know what to do. What do you do when you don't know what to do? Put your eyes on him. Amen. Keep your eyes on him. Keep your eyes on him. A lot of people don't do that. When they get overwhelmed, they take their eyes off God. And they start looking at all sorts of things. They start getting afraid, and their eyes are on their fear. Their eyes are looking at their defeat. But we keep our eyes on him. Amen? Keep your eyes on him. Now, then God answered.
And this is what he said. Then he said, God, listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all you who live in Judah and Jerusalem. This is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, because the battle is not yours, but God's. There's a good one too. Amen. The battle is God's. God says, listen, I'll fight this. You take a seat. I'm going to take care of this. It's my battle. When the enemy comes against you, it is not your battle to fight. You do know that, don't you? I know you run around and think, I got to fix this, and it's my battle, and I got to do something about it. But it is not your battle to fight. It's the Lord's battle. Amen? It's the Lord's battle. And we say, yeah, we are more than conquerors. Yeah, but hang on, just sit down and let him do it. Because the point is, yes, there are things we have to do. We have to walk the walk of faith, and we have to take the actions of faith. But in the end, nothing is going to be done unless God does it. You can't do it. And that's the problem we have sometimes in our prayers, isn't it? Because we go to God, and we actually don't want God to answer our prayer. We want God to do what we want him to do. Now, if you wanted God to answer your prayer, you'd say, like these guys, here's my problem, I'm looking to you. In other words, I don't have an answer. I want your answer. But that's not the way we pray, is it? Most of the time what we pray is, this is what we want. By Thursday at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, I need $2,000. Yeah? Or when I go to the doctor, this is what I want him to say. Or I want you to do that with that person, and I want that job, and I want that pay, and I want her for my wife, and I want him for my husband. See, this is what we want. This is what we pray. We pray for our wants. We pray getting prayers. We pray to get. But we should not pray to get. We should just pray for his will to be done. Isn't that right? See, God is not committed to give you what you want. He's committed to give you what is best. Big difference, isn't it? And he will. But we must be committed to just do what these guys did and say, I'm looking to you. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know what the solution. I have my own ideas, but they're all just human ideas. But you have a better answer, for you do all things well. So give me your answer, God. Give me your answer. Let God do it. Amen? Let God do it. And that's what God's saying. Just let me do it. Don't tell me what to do. Let me do it. I'm God. How can we possibly think that God needs our advice on how to fix one of your problems? If you were that smart, you wouldn't have the problem in the first place. And in the second place, how can you compare our very limited intelligence to the one who created all things? Don't you think he would have a better idea than you? Is that possible? Is that possible? That the God who created heaven and earth may have a better way to fix your problem than you're demanding? Yeah? So just let him do it. Let him do it. And that's what's happening here. Huh? Listen to what God says next. You will not have to fight this battle. So take up your positions. Still got to do that. Stand firm. Still got to do that. And see the deliverance God will give you. Just see it. You're going to see it. It's going to happen, right? Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. And here is the punchline. Go out and face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. You're still going to face it, right? We're still going to have to face our problems. We're still going to have to face up to our difficulties. We're still going to have to get out there, but God is going to do it. Doesn't mean we sit back and do nothing. It means we get out there in faith. Amen? Believe firmly in God, one translation says. Believe firmly in God, and your lives will be firm. Believe firmly in God, and your lives will be firm. Or as another says, you'll come out on top. I like that. When you have strong faith in God, your entire life becomes strong. When you have weak faith in God, your entire life becomes weak. The quality of your life is a product of the quality of your faith. Yeah? fluctuating faith produces a fluctuating experience in life, up and down like yo-yos, never knowing what to depend upon, up and down, good this day, bad tomorrow, happy this day, sad the next day, because your faith is not consistent. But when you lock your faith in on God, it begins to affect every part of your life, your mind, your spirit, your body, every part of your life, your behavior. It all becomes firm and definite and fixed and strong. Yeah? Trust is what makes you strong, trusting God. That's the secret, trusting in God, you know. And that's what he's saying to them. Come on, have some confidence, trust. And when you trust, you are established, you are made strong. Now, we are, around about, let's say, about 4,000 years away from this experience. And they're in another place in Jerusalem. And they're in another culture. So when you start to write these things down, and we begin to read these things, we have to really say that we might be misunderstanding some things. There is a 4,000-year gap, a cultural gap, a language gap, right? And a what would you say? A geographic gap, right? It's massive. So what the translators have to do is they have to try and bridge that gap so that we, in our language today, in this case English, here in Australia, 4,000 years later, can understand it. And they generally do a very good job in the Bible of doing that, right? But sometimes it's just too much to say. There are words that are used that sometimes communicated to people 4,000 years ago in that culture, in that time, in that language, just a single word that communicated ideas that cannot be communicated with the English word to us in our culture today, right now. Isn't that the same with your cultures and your languages? There's a single word, one word. I'm a Welshman. If I say kutch, you don't understand what I mean. If I say kutch to a Welsh person, they'll start to smile, a warm smile. And if I say, give me a kutch, you might say, give me a hug. But if I say, give me a kutch, I can't tell you. How would you ever understand? It's far more than just a hug. It's a kutch is what a child does with a mother. What a man and a woman do when they hug in love. It's a kutch. Now, even that doesn't cover it, see, but it's a word in a language that you don't understand. You could give me your words. Now, this passage of scripture contains words like that. And actually, that word surrounds that idea that the English call trust or faith. So can we unpack it? Because there are four meanings we don't get in the English which come out of this. Okay, the first one. It is, if you trust in the Lord, you will be upheld. Upheld. That sounds nice, doesn't it? You uphold. But it's more than that. The word upheld for them in that day, at that time, described the picture of a mother holding a baby in its arms. So now, what God is saying to them, if you trust me, I will hold you in my arms like a mother holds a baby. Wow. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, look, do you think that you could harm that baby that the mother's holding without paying a very great price? What do you think that mother would do with that baby in her arms? She's going to protect it with her life. Yeah? She's going to give herself for that baby. That's everything. There is a sense of warmth and love and acceptance. There is a sense of being willing to sacrifice. There's a sense of doing anything. There's a sense of protection. And that's what he's saying. If you trust God, in turn, God will wrap you up in his arms and hold you like a mother holds a child. When you trust God, he takes care of you. Amen? When you have faith in God, he takes care of you. That's the first thing. But there's a second idea here. And you find this in the Message translation where he tries to get something across. And he says, believe firmly in your God and your lives will be firm. 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 Fixed. Unmovable. The idea here is a picture of a peg that's driven into the wall. You drive the peg in the wall, right? And you can hang something on it. Now, a few years back, in where I live, we had one of those micro storms came through. And we had massive hailstones, you know, size of, bigger than golf balls, size of your fist. Now, I, being fascinated, ran out the front to take some pictures of these hailstones. And I had my camera out, and I thought, I'll get some pictures here. And then I heard a scream inside the house. So I ran back inside the house, and what had happened was the hailstones had smashed through the windows of the house. They came straight through, and they shredded the blinds, which we had just put up that week, and they smashed onto the floor, and the rain was coming in, the wind was coming in, and my wife was, it's bashing. It broke palings on the fence. It broke tiles on the roof. It smashed up everything. Yeah, $30,000 of damage within 4 or 5 minutes. Beat up the whole house and everybody else's. But I had to fix this problem. Being the man of the house, it's my responsibility. So I ran outside, putting my life on the line, as you do, guys. You know what I mean? You put the life on the line. I ran out. I got a piece of plywood that I had behind the garage, grabbed it out here, and then I went inside the garage. I got myself a hammer, and I thought, I need a nail. I need a nail. Now, I'm not a carpenter, so, you know, I just grabbed the only nail I could find, and I thought, this will do the job, a 6-inch nail. I had one nail, but it was a good one. I put this thing up against the window, and I put it there, and I hit that nail. And it wouldn't go in. And I hit it, and I drove it, and bang, and I thought, this is going to hold up during the storm. And I kept on hitting and hitting till that thing was all the way in. You were not going to move that piece off, you know, I'm telling you, that was there for good. A couple of hours later, a guy knocked on the door. He says, I'm a glazer. Oh, he was a clever man. He said, have you got any broken glass? I said, come on in. I said, yes, you can fix the glass here. So he's going to fix the glass. He comes outside. He has a look at this plywood nail to the thing, and he just sees a head of a nail, you see? So he pulls the plywood. It's not coming off, okay? And then he gets, I don't know, he's out there doing this, and I'm sort of standing there, look a bit sheepish. And then he starts, he said, I can't get this out. He said, this looks like a 6-inch nail. Who did that? Yeah, who would have done that stupid sort of stuff? Who did that? But I'm telling you, that's still in there. It's still in there. He couldn't get it out. Why? It's fixed in place. That's the picture here. That's God's. When you trust in me, I'll fix you like a nail in a wall. You will not be moved. No matter what beats against you, no matter what comes against you, no matter what opposes you, I'm going to hold you in that place. You will not be moved. Faith is like that. Faith says, I will not be moved. I'm not going to give in. I'm not going to give way. I'm not going to back down. I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to surrender. I'm not going to retreat. I'm going to stand up in faith. That's a faith picture here. Amen. That's what it is. And men and women of faith, that's their spirit. Amen. Not quick to quit. Yeah? If you stand up and stand strong, remember the fight is not yours, but you've got to stand strong. If you run away, there can be no fight. God can't win it for you when you're running away. You can't have victory if you back down. Yeah? You can't do it. You've got to make that decision that the prophets made. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. There's some grit there. So there's two beautiful pictures. The mother holding the baby, the nail in the wall. But then there's a third one. And I really like this one. The third one is the word that sometimes the translators translate as steadfast in this. You will become steadfast. If you trust in the Lord, you will be steadfast. Steadfast is an old-fashioned word, but you mean it means to stand fast, to be steady in one place, yeah? To be fixed in one spot, a little bit like the nail, but a little bit more. It's fixed in a place. You won't move. You're determined to stand and hold your ground. It's like in the Bible. when they talk about soldiers. Quit you like men, stand fast. All right? Be strong. Quit you like men, stand fast. That's got a funny ring to it, hasn't it? It's a funny ring because it's what soldiers would say when they're about to go into battle. In an ancient battle, the soldiers would stand shoulder to shoulder with their shields and they would advance and beat the shield. Woo, 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 woo. Did you get the soldier? Woo, woo, woo. That's the picture. Stand fast. If one of you turns around to run, we'll all die. Because with a hole in the line, the enemy comes through. Stand fast. Lock your shields. Stand fast. Stand fast. Stand fast. But there's more to this. Because that word is also used in the book of Job, chapter 39, where it refers to the war horse. A war horse. Not a racing horse, okay? You know, the racing horse is to the war horse what a greyhound is to a rockwheeler. And the war horse is a rockwheeler. A war horse is bred for war. It's not a small horse. It's not a dainty horse. It's not a dancy horse. It's not a fast horse. It's a brute. It's massive. It's bred for its size. It's big. It's tall. It's powerful. It's strong. But then it is trained for war. For the war horse not just carries the warrior, the war horse is a weapon itself. The war horse not only tries to smash and trample down the enemy, but the war horse will bite the enemy, kick the enemy, do anything possible. You see this thing? It's going to come right at you. And it's snorting. And there's stuff coming out of its nose and froth out of its mouth. And it's making a noise. And you're going to stand there? I don't think so. You're going to run. Because if you stand there, that thing's going to kill you. It's going to run right over the top of you. And if you're at the side, it'll bite your head off. It's trained for war. It's vicious. Nasty. Trained for battle. But in this picture, the idea is of a war horse with a warrior sitting atop with all his armor and his weaponry. He's sitting atop this horse and they're ready to go into battle. And what you see is a warrior saying to his horse, no, no, oh, hold back, hold back. And the horse is going, let me at him. I'll kill him. I'll trample them. That's the one who has faith. Not timid and fearful. Come on then. Come on then. Give me the best you've got. Come on, God. Let's go. Come on, God. We're going to kill them all. We're going to wipe them. We're going to do it. Come on, God. That's a man and woman of faith. Not,
oh God, please.
No. I'm ready. When you go to work tomorrow, you can go like a pussycat or you can go like a war horse. The choice is yours. But if you have faith, you'll step out like a war horse and say, bring it on, I'm ready. God's on my side. I've got a promise of victory and success. Nothing can defeat me. Come on, bring it on. Hallelujah. It's a great picture, isn't it? But there's one more. And the other one you already know. Well, you're already familiar with it because it is translated by some of the translators. Instead of the word trust, the word is amen. Amen is a trust word. I know we tag it on the end of our prayers. Like it's a little formula to finish off with. I mean, how do you finish a prayer? Oh, say amen. Okay. That finishes off like over and out. Amen. But it's more than that. The word means, as you already know, so be it. Let it be done. But it's not, oh, well, so be it. No, this is it. That's it now. It's finished. It's done. Done. Right? I'm done. It's done. I've prayed. And it's done. Huh? What needs to be done is done. That's an end to it. I'm going to trust you now. I'm not saying you should only pray once and then say amen. But I'm saying that when you do pray and you say amen, what you've just said is, I trust you to fulfill this promise of God. I trust you that you're going to bring the answer. I trust that you're going to intervene, that you're going to invade my world, that you're going to do what is necessary and bring about the best answer, your answer. That's it. It's done. Do you have a sense of completion? And if you can't say it's done, don't stop praying till you can. Now, I know the clock might be against you, and you might say, okay, Lord, I'm coming back to this later. And you go back to God and you pray again. And you don't feel that's done, so you come back to God and you pray again. You keep praying again, and you keep praying again until you can say within your heart and within your spirit, that's it, it's done. It's done. Amen? When it's done, it's done. And when it's done, it's done whether you see it as being done or not. It's done. Before it can be done for you, it must first be done in heaven. Yeah? Isn't that what he already told you? Isn't that what you already pray? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come in earth as it is in heaven. It's already done in heaven as it is in heaven. Now make it done on the earth. So we're going to pray, Lord, for this to be done on earth. Your will, not mine. What you want, not what I want. Your solution, not my solution. I want you to do it on the earth, just as it's being done already in heaven. Now, it's already done in heaven. Because it's done in heaven, it will be done on earth. Amen? Amen. It will be done on earth. So the amen is that trust. I'm leaving it to you now, God. It belongs to you. That's it. Roll it over. No anxiety. I'm just going to step out there and do it. Yeah? Now, you think that was the end, okay? And really, it sort of is the end of the story in one way, except now that this guy, Jehoshaphat, does the dumbest thing he possibly could do. Well, it looks like that, because it says, after consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men. There's no inference at all about misogyny or anything. It just happened to be that, never mind. The culture of the day. Anyway. Okay. I don't want to dig too deep a hole here. But anyway, he appointed men to sing to the Lord and praise him for the splendor of his holiness. Well, that's nice. But then notice what he did. And they went out, the singing men, as the head of the army. So what he did was, you'd like this, Christian. He got all his musicians and singers, and he says, we're going to go into battle. Here we are with all our shields and our swords and our helmets, and we're ready to go, and we're ready for the battle, and we're battle-hardened warriors. But see, all you singing guys, you're going to stand in front between us and the enemy. Now, well, how's that for a battle strategy? Let them wipe out the singers first. You know, we can do without them. They don't do much anyway. They're just singing. So we just wipe them out, you know. They can be cannon fodder. Trampled. But that's not what he's doing. Thank goodness. You see, what he's doing is he's actually saying, listen, I'm going to put all these singing guys and all these musician guys out front. And they're going to march in front of us because really, what does he do? He knows he doesn't have to fight. He knows. He's putting faith into action. Now, if he'd put the singers behind, say, you stand behind us, boys, and you sing from the back, then he would know that he intended to have a fight, that he didn't really believe that God was going to do this for him. But when he shifted all his singers to the front, then you absolutely know this guy did not intend to go into battle. He knew that there was going to be a victory, but he put the singers in front. Amen. Can I say this to you? When you face up to your problem, yet face it like a war horse. Face it with confidence in God that he has you in his arm like a mother. Face it with that fixed determination of a nail in a wall. But also remember this, when you face this problem, when you face this difficulty in faith, when you stand up against the enemy, when you come up against that thing which is opposing you and resisting you, over which you must triumph, just remember this at all times. God's going to do it. God's going to do it. God's going to do it. And all you need to do is sing. Hey? Sing. Give him praise. Praise is an expression of your faith. You don't have to go and say, well, I'm going to punch him in the head. No, you go in singing. You go in singing. See, you go into that workplace which has been a problem and a pain for you tomorrow. You go in singing, they're going to be puzzled. They're not going to know what's going on. They're going to think you should be going in worried. Maybe you should be going in angry. Maybe you should go, I'm going to start. I'm going to tell you what. Now, you go in singing with a smile on your face because you've got faith in God. You've got the joy of the Lord in your heart. You just step into that thing. Step into that thing. And you go in singing. And God will give you victory and success in your situation. Amen? Go in singing. When they're wheeling you down the corridor. You ever been wheeled down the corridor in a hospital going in to get your operation and you see the lights going overhead? And they say, are you all right? How do you go in? A panic? Or do you go in peacefully? You got a song in your heart?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Are you singing to the Lord? Are you giving praise to God? Hey, how do you go in? How do you face up to that problem? Perhaps some of you going from here, you're going to some family function. Boy, if ever you need the joy of the Lord, you're going to go to some of these family functions, I'm telling you. Let's face it, people come to family functions you would not normally bother with. Isn't that right? We've all got one of those uncles or crazy aunties or something like that. But you want to go there? Go with singing. Let the praise of the Lord be upon your lips. Song of the Lord in your heart. That's an expression of faith because you're not worrying. See, you're not worried. You're trusting God. You're not anxious. You're trusting in God. And that's what Jehoshaphat did. And he sent them all in. And the singers were singing. And the soldiers were behind saying, this is going to be interesting. You'll wash all those singers getting wiped out. You know, wow, this is going to be real fun. And then when they came into the valley, what did they see? All these different groups of people that had come against him, they overnight had had some sort of disagreement. They were slaughtering each other, killing each other by the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. And so the guys kept singing, and the soldiers kept cheering, and they just killed each other, wiped each other out, gone. Now, who would have thought of that? Another time, another man came to Jerusalem to try exactly the same trick, only he had an even bigger army, and he was even more powerful and more successful than all these tribal people who came against Jerusalem. And the king at that time prayed. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible says, I will put a hook in his nose and drag him off. Can you see how humiliating that is? That the God of heaven and earth says, I can fix this problem. I just stick a hook in his nose and pull him off. Come on. You see that? Come on. A hook in your nose. A hook in your nose. And that's how God described what I'm going to do. He's saying, just stick a hook in his nose and I'll pull him off. You think it's a problem to God? You think it's a problem to God? You think this is too big for the creator of heaven and earth? You think this is too great for the master of the whole universe? You think your problem's too tough? Your difficulty's too difficult, too complex? It's impossible? Just because you can't see an answer doesn't mean there's no answer. He can just put a hook in it and pull it out the way. It's a little thing for God. It's a little thing for God. It's a little thing for God. It's big for you. It's little for him. It's nothing for God. Nothing. Nothing. No, God does not exert himself. the 6 days of creation happened. Then there's a seventh day, which is the day of rest. Where is the eighth day? Oh, you never thought of that, did you? There isn't one. The writer to the Hebrews says, this is the Sabbath rest day. We would enter into the day. Enter into it. Your rest is now through Jesus Christ. You don't have to strive. You don't have to struggle. You don't have to fight. You enter into that day. But do you know that God is still resting? Why is he resting? Well, what do you think he has to do? It's nothing. It's simple. Yeah, fix that problem. Yeah, okay. Fix that problem. Yeah. Angel, we'll just speak a word. He can create a universe with a word. You think your problem's going to cause him to sweat? Does he get anxious about, oh, dear, oh, what can I do? Oh, Ralph, I don't know, man. You got any ideas? What can I do, Ralph? What can I do? No. He knew it was there before you even found it. He knows the answer before you were born. Amen? And the only reason you have it in the first place is because he let you have it. Why does God let me go through all of this? Because he wants you to grow up. He wants you to become strong. He's a father who wants to protect you, yes, but he knows you have to experience the realities of life in order to be mature and stronger. Do you see what I'm saying? You're in good hands. Just trust him. Amen. Trust him. And your whole life will be strong. Would you stand with me, please? This is a privilege and an opportunity for me today to be with you. But I believe we've had a divine appointment this morning, not just in the worship, but between you and God this morning. Would you bow your heads with me right now? Because the Holy Spirit has spoken in this place today. Not me. The Holy Spirit has spoken. I don't know what he said to you. I know what I've said, but he doesn't always say what I say. There's been a quickening in your heart and a moving in your soul. And you're aware that God has spoken to me. Something has happened. There's something he has said. And you need to respond to that right now. To that quickening, to that working, to that witness of the Spirit that you have, that the Holy Spirit has now spoken into your life. And I'm going to ask you to do that right now. Just lift your heart before God. Acknowledge him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, you have spoken to me today. Thank you, Lord, I acknowledge receiving your word. Thank you for sowing that seed of faith into my life. Thank you for speaking into my circumstance and situation. I'm going to respond to that right now, Father, by embracing that word, by applying that word, by trusting in that word. And I know that when I walk out of here, Father, I'm walking out to something. I'm walking out to victory and success and blessing. I'm walking out of this to solutions and directions that I never knew were possible. I'm walking out, Father, and I'm believing that I'm going to see things changing in my world because what you've deposited in my life, and I pray that you would change me, that you would change my attitude, change my direction, change me, Father, that my faith may be stronger in you, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, church. Thank you.
Come on, enjoy it. Give it up for Pastor Alan for the incredible word. And I'm wondering if you can take your seats for one more moment this morning. What I love and have always loved about the word that Pastor Alan brings, it's so matter of fact. It's not based on opinion or emotion, but the word of God. And today, it's a matter of fact that if you're here visiting, if you're here for a first time, second time, third time, it's still a coincidence that God has brought you to this house on this morning. It's not a coincidence that you're here. And we wouldn't want to conclude today's service without extending an invitation to everyone in the room to accept the Lord Jesus as their personal Lord and Savior. As you heard the word today, if you're tired of fighting in your own strength, If you're tired of having to live in anxiety, in stress, you need to know that the Lord is here to fight your battles, and He's already won the battle for you, and He won it on the cross. On the cross. So I'm wondering if we can just all bow our heads for a moment of privacy around this auditorium. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whomever would believe in Him would not perish, but have eternal life." And Jesus paid the ultimate price on the cross to restore us back to God, back to His family, to fight our battles, and to life everlasting. And the truth is that all of us have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, but let me tell you, God is calling you home. It's not a coincidence that you're here this morning. Let me tell you, there's forgiveness in God. There is peace, there is joy, there is freedom, and it's all found in Jesus. Jesus loves you, and He always has. And today, if you want to be sure without a shadow of a doubt that you are forgiven and you want to experience that life, you want to experience the love of God, you want to experience a God that fights your battles for you, that has already won, the first step is simply to say yes and accept the invitation of salvation. And I'm going to count to three this morning. And if that's you, I'm going to ask that you raise your hand as a sign of confirmation that you want to make that decision this morning. So from the back to the front, from the left to the right, if that's you, if this word has stirred in your heart and you are tired of running, you are tired of fighting your own battles, and you want to come home to a God that has won the battle for you already, I'm going to ask you to lift your hands. 1, 2, 3. If that's you this morning, I see that hand, sister. I see that hand. Come on, church. I see that hand, brother, at the back. God is fighting your battles. Come on, church. Give it up. Is there anyone else in this house this morning that wants to give their life? I see that hand, sister, right at the back. That is an awesome decision. That is an awesome decision. Church, why don't we pray this together? Dear Jesus, today I give you my life. I ask you to forgive me of my sins and to help me to live a life that is pleasing and honoring of you. I believe from this day on that you are my Savior, that you are my Lord, that you are my friend. And from this day on, I will never be the same again. In Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen, amen. To everyone that lifted their hands, you've made an incredible decision. Our new Christians team have seen your hand, and they would love to give you a Bible and talk to you about your next steps out in the foyer at the Hub. Church, one more moment as we invite Pastor Mick Reeves to the platform.
Who enjoyed that message from Pastor Alan this morning? Can we just give him some appreciation this morning? Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Well, right now we're going to take an opportunity to take up a ministry offering, because what we want to do is we want to bless this wonderful couple. And so the giving options will be up on the screen. Maybe you want to give via envelope, and you can do that if you are going to give via envelope. Could you make sure you tick the box where it says guest speaker? I want to give you the time to just prepare for that now. But it just seems to me that every time that you both come, that you richly deposit into our church, every single time. And so today we say thank you so much for, again, richly depositing into our lives, personal lives, but also into our church. And so thank you so much for that. And so, church, yeah, absolutely. Why don't we give them a round of applause, because it's a long-term relationship, and you really have been a father and mother in this house, and we see you very much as that. But church, we get the opportunity to do exactly the same thing. We get the chance to richly deposit into the lives of this incredible couple. And so as you prepare that, what we're going to do right now is we're going to pray over them. And so I want to encourage you just to stretch out your arms, and we're going to pray blessing over this couple. Father, we thank you, Lord, for Pastor Alan and Joan Davies. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for their many, many years of faithful service. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for the sacrifices they've made, the risks that they have taken, Lord. Lord, for the burdens that they have carried. I thank you, Lord, for the rich deposits that they have left in many spaces that go beyond this country. I thank you, Lord, for the individual lives, Lord, that they have personally shepherded, personally discipled. Today, Father, we have been blessed, and we thank you for them. We thank you, Lord, for the way that you use them so powerfully, Lord, in your body. But today we ask, Lord, that you would continue, Lord, to further them, continue to bless them, to continue to increase all that they put their hand upon. I pray, Lord, for those things within their heart, those things that they long to see. Lord, may you make them possible. Lord, may you bless their family. Lord, may you bless them with great favor and protection, Lord. May you continue to refresh them, Lord, as they continue to minister to the body of Christ. So today, Lord, bless them immensely in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, church, you know that our service doesn't finish here. We're about to go and hang out in the foyer with a hot drink or a cold drink. But let me give you two reminders. We have Grow Track in the second service. If you have not ever done Grow Track, you've got to do it. Hang about and stay for the second service and do Grow Track. Also at 5 p.m. today in the East location, we have an Open Heaven Night hosted by our wonderful pastors over there, Pastor Danny and Bindi Major. So feel free to make your way over there for 5 p.m. But for everyone else, have an incredible week. Make sure you go out, say hello to someone you don't know, buy someone a coffee or a cold drink, and have a blessed day. God bless your church. Thank you.
I need your all I need. You're my physician. Though my flesh may fail, you'll heal me. You'll heal me. You are my shepherd. Though I may lose my way, you'll find me. You'll find me. And all I need, your love and protection covers me. And all I need, you're all I need. Shepherd King, you never leave me. You never leave me. You're by my side. Shepherd King, you never leave me. You never leave me. You're by my side. Though my world may fall, you're there. Though my fear stands tall, you're there. Though my guilt